Hi, and welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and in the last video, we talked about greaves, or the defense for the lower leg, and in this video, we're going to talk about the remainder of the leg harness. In my case, articulated cuisses, pullings, and demigreaves. Stepping back historically for a moment, let's just take a look at the overview of thigh protection. Just like in the last video with greaves, we see mail as the predominant protection for the upper leg prior to the advent of plate around the early 14th century. You have different styles of chausses, just like we saw previously. But then what happens is plate starts to get used again as supplementation for mail. One of the most common things that you see early on is the addition of a floating kneecap. And when I say that, what I mean is just the knee plate itself, with its own straps, not attached to any other component of a leg harness, strapped directly over the knee on a pair of mail chausses, worn over the mail chausses. Then we're going to start to see the other components of the leg harness show up in a configuration called a floating leg harness, where they're not actually articulated together, but all the components are present. Ultimately, by about the mid-14th century, we start to see the fully articulated leg harness, like what you see here, where all the components are permanently assembled to each other. This basic formula for a leg harness with sabatons, separate greaves, and then the remainder of the leg harness articulated as one piece would be a very common configuration from about the mid-14th century through the 15th century. The differences that you see are going to be stylistic, some structural differences, but the basic construction of a cuisse, pauline, and demi-greave are going to remain very similar. So some of the differences that you will see, for example, in the 15th century, the fan that protects the inside of the knee joint may start to get bigger. They're going to experiment with different shapes of fans and things like that. You'll also see experimentation on the upper thigh with stop ribs. You'll see it's basically a ridge of steel or iron attached to the top of the plate itself. And what that does is, with a ridge of steel here, if a blade were to catch on the cuisse and glance up the cuisse, it's going to hit that instead of going over the top edge and into the groin. Another thing that changes over time is the shape of the upper edge of the thigh. When some of the earliest examples, the top of the thigh seems to be pretty level, pretty flat, and then over time you see the outside of the leg start to grow to protect more and more of the hip until you'll see examples in late Gothic armor where the outside of the cuisse comes up and covers very high up over the hip. You also have many alternatives to the previously discussed leg defenses, like textile defenses, where you're wearing padded garments or layered garments quilted together as a sole means of protection or as supplementation to one of the other methods. For example, we have documentary evidence for mail actually being sandwiched between two layers of textile, where you have a layer of textile against your skin, and then the mail over that, and then an additional layer of padding on top of the mail. You also have alternatives like splinted cuisses, where you have a foundation of leather or fabric where splints of iron or steel are riveted to that. And then you actually have these strips running under the leather fabric. So you can imagine this being made from leather, and then on the inside of that, just strips of steel without the actual solid plates like this. So there are alternatives. None of these solutions is exclusive or universal to what everybody was wearing at the time. I'd also like to take a look here at Doug's analysis of funeral effigies for leg harnesses from the period of 1300 to 1450. So you can see here the progression of and frequency of how often some of these different solutions show up. Okay, so let's take a closer look at what I wear. Now, my leg harness here is specific to the late 14th, early 15th century style. So, smaller fan type, no stop ribs or anything like that. We do have some extension of the outside of the leg here. It's not completely flat on top, and it's configured to receive a greave. So terminology, the cuisse is the part that protects the thigh. The pollain is the part that protects the knee. These are just additional lames that allow movement and articulation. And then the piece that hangs off the bottom of the knee pollain is called a demi-greave, and this hole here is configured to receive the pin on the greaves. Looking at the other side, mine are set up with a steel plate in the back that protects the outside back of the thigh. On the inside of the thigh, I just have a section of leather. Now, this configuration is by no means universal. We see a lot of different examples and styles of how the back of the leg is protected. There are examples where the entire back of the leg is enclosed in steel. We have examples like this where you do have sections that are not defended or may have been defended with leather. Now, one possible reason for this kind of configuration is that if you imagine a man-at-arms in armor on horseback, the inside of the thigh is the part of the leg that comes in direct contact with the horse. So having leather there or nothing at all allows greater feel for the rider with his horse. Having steel here, you're not going to have that direct connection with the horse. Again, it's all a trade-off for certain advantages versus more complete protection. The back of the knee is not directly defended, it is indirectly defended by the fan. So what the fan does is it prevents somebody from hitting the back of the knee from anywhere other than directly behind you. If someone's in front of you, obviously the back of the knee is a hard target, but if they're off to the side at an angle offline from you directly, swinging something from the outside of the leg is going to hit this fan before it can wrap around and actually get into the back of the knee. As the knee closes, you can see that that fan fills up that gap as well, providing additional protection. Okay, so now let's take a look at how the upper leg harness interfaces with the greaves. This is the configuration for the right leg. This is the right greave and the right cuisse. You can always tell because the fan goes on the outside of the leg. And remember, on the greave itself, we have a pin on the shin plate that corresponds to the hole on the demi-greave. And then in the back, we have that staple for the strap on the demi-greave. So the first thing we want to do is align the pin with the hole. Once the pin is through, then when this is being worn on the leg, you would pass the strap of the demi-greave here through the staple. And then strap it closed. Now, the pin and hole configuration is again not universal. The staple is commonly seen, the hole is less commonly seen, but I elected to go with it because it does make for a much more secure fit. Now, when the two are strapped together and pinned together, you can see here when I lift the leg harness, everything goes together and functions as one unit. To disassemble it, simply unstrap, remove from the staple, and withdraw the pin from the hole. Okay, so when I was originally making this video, I wanted to show you how the entire leg harness assembly functions with the arming garment. What I'm going to do is separate that into its own video, which I'll release very shortly after this one, because the topic of historical leg suspension is so important that I wanted to give it its own discussion. So that's going to conclude everything I want to talk about the cuisses that I wear with my kit. If you have any questions about what I wear specifically, please leave them below and I will do my best to answer them. And as always, if you like the video, please like and subscribe, and I will be back in the next video showing you how to point your legs to your arming garments. Thank you very much.
Now,
this is intentional.
This is probably
the way
most important
that
piece of
the steel,
whole,
in this case, is spring steel, it's hardened. So it always
what
wants
this does
to
is it
return
forms
to
the
shape
for my
that
nail
it was
shirt
formed
in
into.
So, what you'll notice right off
hardening.
The bat is you can see quilting lines.
When you
close. So